So we were talking about this heterostructure between amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon, which is used in the head cell. And I'm sorry, I got a phone call in between, so I had to cut short the previous video. So looking at this heterostructure, I mentioned that the surface recombination velocity at this interface between the amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon are usually pretty low. So this interface is very well passivated, and this surface recombination velocity are less than 100 centimeter per second. So these surface, there's a caveat associated with this. The caveat is that these surface recombination velocities, which are low, or this good surface passivation, is only realized when this amorphous silicon layer is intrinsic. That is, if this amorphous silicon layer is undoped. If you try to dope these amorphous silicon layer to either N or P type to make junctions, then you don't realize these are good surface recombination velocity. So then that presents a challenge, and that presents a challenge because you have these high offset, you know, you have this high conduction band and valence band offset, and you could utilize one of these offsets. So for example, if you want to make a good hole barrier layer, then this offset would essentially, you know, prevent your holes from coming through. But you also have this conduction band offset, so it will also repel off the electron which are trying to get collected at this side as well. So you see that presence of both these offsets block the holes, but they also block the electron. So you see we have a problem in hand, and we need to solve it somehow. And the way it's solved it is again by using this head design, that is using the heterostructure, but with a thin interface there. So this this figure over here, it illustrates this head design. So we still keep this heterostructure between the amorphous and crystalline silicon layer. And we also keep the intrinsic layer because that's what gives me the good surface recombination velocity. So at the surface, I essentially keep this eye layer, or this intrinsic layer. But now if I want to make a good selective contact which collects my electron, I dope this this following layer after the eye intrinsic layer to be N plus type. So now I get a band alignment like this. So for example, if I was in equilibrium, I would have a Fermi level lined up like this. So I've doped my N plus amorphous silicon layer high, and I'm getting a band lineup like this. So now I still get a very high barrier for my holes over here. So these holes which love to travel up the hill, they see this barrier and they're not collected. But at the same time, I have reduced the barrier for these electrons to be collected in this N plus layer. So now these electrons can tunnel through this I layer and they can be collected at this contact. Similarly over here, if I want to make a selective contact for my for collecting my holes, I still keep this intrinsic layer at the interface with my crystalline silicon. That gives me a good surface recombination velocity at this interface. But now I've placed a P plus layer on top of it. So I've placed this P plus layer on top. For the case of electrons, which love to travel down the hill, when they reach this contact, they are repelled back, and this offset in the conduction band, as well as this field which is present here, helps in repelling this electrons. But it also assists in the collection of these holes. And these holes can now essentially tunnel through this intrinsic layer and collect and get collected in this P plus amorphous silicon layer. And this tunneling, or you know, collection of these couriers, these electrons and holes in this way, essentially this is the reason why this intrinsic layer has to be thin, and that's the reason for this T in this head design. So if I consider the case, if I did not make this intrinsic layer thin, so instead of having this instead of having a thin intrinsic layer, if I had a thick intrinsic layer, then I'll get a much narrower I'll get a band lineup like this, where I'll get a smaller electric field, and I'll get a much larger barrier over here for the collecting these carriers, and that wouldn't be a very good contact for collecting electrons over here. Especially if similarly, if I made the intrinsic layer thick over here, it would the electric field in this region would decrease, and my band lineup would look something like this. So now my hole has to travel a much larger distance before it can tunnel through or it can get collected. So this is the reason why we need to keep this intrinsic layer, its thickness, to be thin. So now if I want to make a selective contact for collecting electrons, I essentially place this N plus amorphous silicon layer. And if I want to make this selective contact for holes, I place this P plus amorphous silicon layer on top of this intrinsic amorphous silicon layer. So now let me show you the band diagram of the final device. So this is the band diagram for the cell. And you can see that I have this intrinsic layer, which is touching both the front side and the back side. So I have light shining from the front side. So this is the front side, and I have light coming in from here. And hopefully most of the light will essentially get absorbed in this crystalline silicon layer over here, because this band gap of the amorphous silicon is high. So it will act as a good window layer, which acts as a good window for letting this light into my crystalline silicon layer. And now when my electron and hole pairs, they are generated inside this crystalline silicon. So now when this holes come close to this contact, they will be repelled back because of this high offset. And also holes love to travel up the hill. They love to travel up the hill, so they see this down the hill electric field over here. But if my electrons come close to the front contact, they love to travel down the hill, and also this barrier which is present over here is also significantly reduced. So now these electrons can tunnel through this barrier, and they are now collected inside this n-doped amorphous silicon layer on the top. And you can see that it only collects electrons, and the holes are repelled away. Similarly, my holes, when they reach the back contact over here, back surface over here, they see that they do see a barrier over here, but it is substantially reduced because of this presence of this heavily doped p-type amorphous silicon over here. So these holes can now tunnel through this barrier, and they love to travel up the hill, and this field over here is suitable for that. So they'll tunnel through here and get collected in this P amorphous silicon layer. And also this P amorphous silicon layer, it will repel back the electrons which want to get collected. So now I've realized these selective contacts very nicely using these heterostructure and using this thin amorphous silicon layer, which is intrinsic in nature. So that helps me achieve this good surface recombination velocity. While you realize these selective contacts by doping these in amorphous silicon layer, n-type on the front and p-type on the back. Another advantage that I must mention that you get by realizing these junctions in this amorphous silicon layer is that now you can form these junctions during growth. So you don't need a very high temperature process to essentially dope these crystalline silicon layers using a diffusion or activating these implants, which typically require a very a large thermal budget or require high temperature. As a result of that, this whole cell can be formed at a very low temperature process flow. Another thing which I should mention is that though we use this P plus and N plus amorphous silicon layers to realize the selective contacts, the mobility of carriers, that is the mobility of electrons and holes in this amorphous silicon layers, are typically very low because this material is amorphous and hence it does not have a very high mobility. And also it's difficult to dope these amorphous silicon layer very high, so it sometimes suffers suffers from low active doping concentration as well. As a result of both of these, the sheet resistance of these layers, these N plus and P plus amorphous silicon layer, is typically very high. So to form a good contact with low resistivity, usually what is done is that conducting oxide is sputtered on top of this, on top of both this amorphous silicon layer on the top and also this amorphous silicon layer at the bottom. So you sputter a conductive oxide such as indium tin oxide or ITO, and this is this has high conductivity, or at least higher conductivity as compared to the amorphous silicon layers, and also it has a much larger band gap as compared to the cell. So it does not absorb or essentially absorb any of the solar spectrum which is incoming on the cell. So this is another feature which is used in this head cell. So in the next video, I'll talk about some of the unique features or some of the unique device characteristics which result from this design. So see you in the next video.